Morning.
Good morning.
It's Monday.
It's Monday. Hope everybody had a good weekend.
We did. We had a good weekend.
We had a good,
even though it was freezing.
Yeah, and mostly indoor.
Yeah, well, yes. It has to be indoors. It's yes. So cold. Yes.
Go ahead. I felt like all day all we did was eat.
We did yesterday.
It was so funny.
We were like, why are we so hungry? But we ate and we ate and we ate and it was so nice.
Yes, and I still woke up late this morning.
Yeah, that's the thing about being plant-based is you can eat as much as you want and it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So I wrote it all down so you'll see.
I forgot to set the
timer. Oh, you forgot to set the timer for his tea. You'll see when we get the website up, I'll have the on our food journal, you'll see all the stuff we ate yesterday. I had figs and I had an apple and I had a grapefruit and I had
bread and hummus. Yummy bread, I might add.
He made bread. I posted that picture. You guys probably saw it.
Yes.
So that's cool. But yeah, we ate a lot yesterday. How was your workout this morning?
I had a great workout today.
Yeah.
Maybe because of all the food I ate yesterday. I had so much energy working out today. It was incredible.
That's good. What'd you do?
I did back and then I did core abs.
Yeah.
It was great.
That's good. Yeah. I did back as well, and I had a good workout. I have to give a shout out to my massage therapist who came into work yesterday on a Sunday to make up for the appointment that got canceled because of snow on Thursday, and he worked on my shoulder. So my shoulder's better. Thank you to Dave. It needed relief.
Yeah. Thank you, Dave.
Good morning, Sean, or good evening, Sean, since you're in Kuala Lumpur.
Right, exactly.
So, yeah, it was great. It's cold here.
Yes,
Sean,
it's very cold.
You know that.
Yes, I think you're aware.
And we're supposed to get freezing rain tonight.
Right.
So yeah,
but it starts getting warmer after today.
It does. We're supposed to hit 50 by the weekend. So yay!
I'm going to get a bathing suit.
Okay.
I'm just going to have a bathing suit and say, there it is.
So I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about the nutrition class I'm taking. And a lot of it, you know, as is typical with academia, it's so funny. When they test you, they don't test you the stuff that's actually useful to remember. They test you on the stuff that's like, why would I ever need to know that? Like, what date
back
did they
set? Back in 1917.
It's crazy. But the first couple of modules were about the nutrition paradigm and how we've ended up in the place that we are where we believe that meat is so important. And that's become part of our truth, even though it's not really real.
It's not true.
But it's part of the American truth. And how we got there and how the government and science were trying to create wealth for farmers by getting people to eat more stuff. So I thought that it was interesting, but there was a whole module about the paradigm. But one thing I found really interesting, and it didn't occur to me, but when they said it, I was like, yeah, duh. So the supplement industry is an $11 billion a year industry. But what they look at is they look at plants because plants are good for us. Obviously. So they study plants, but when they find something in a plant that is particularly good for us, they can't patent that because you can't patent
a plant. Thou shalt not grow that plant.
And so they don't tell us about the plant. What they do is they take whatever that nutrient or vitamin or mineral or whatever it is that they find in that plant that's good for us, and they create a synthetic version of it.
Right.
And then they can patent that and they can sell that to us.
Right. And as
as
we have learned, you can't take one element out of a plant, for instance, because that's what we're talking about here, and use it as a benefit, because the fact that it's in the plant in a proportion that it is, and when you eat that plant,
the package,
everything else that's in that plant is important to the nutrient. And when you take it out of there, you've just taken everything that makes it useful out.
Right. So I thought that was interesting, that they create synthetic versions and they don't tell us about the food that the plant they actually found that is healthy for us. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, and this one lovely journal thing I'm taking notes in, this is from my friend Trish from her business, Write Stuff. So thank you for Trish for sending me the journal that I'm taking
notes
in.
She loves journals.
I do. I take notes in them and they're fun. So let's see, what else did I find? There's tons and tons, and I'll type all this up and it'll be on part of the website on my notes and quotes. Oh, Did you know that there's a lobbying the government for junk food? There's a lobby for the groceries. There's a lobby for the beverage association. There's a lobby for restaurants. And sometimes they decide that they want to work together and they all lobby together. And sometimes they lobby separately. But one of the things they do is they create these fake grassroots organizations where so the example they used was in New York when they tried to have a tax on soda or make a size
limit
on
the
sodas.
Amount that you could sell.
There were all these t-shirts that says, I can choose my own size drink, I'm an adult. And that looked like it was grassroots. It was actually the Beverage Association funded that whole thing.
Yeah.
So I thought that was crazy.
They have the money to fight back. Absolutely.
And they do. Yeah, they absolutely do. Let's see, what else did I find? Oh, so this is kind of a little bit sad. Cheese is the single largest source of saturated fat in the American diet.
Yes.
Beef is number two.
Right.
So we love cheese.
We do love cheese, although we have not eaten it in a long time.
Long, long time. Because it's just, it's straight saturated fat.
Right. And if we are going to have cheese, we're going to buy, we used to get cheese at Costco, so you know.
Huge. Cheese. Yeah. Pounds.
Now we've decided that if we are going to have cheese, we're going to get the smallest piece we can buy so that we just eat it.
It'll be a one day treat thing. Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Hey, Bridge, I'll read your comment after, because I can't read it right now from here. I didn't make it big enough. And I'll reply. You know, I'll reply afterwards. When one woman made up a word, she called it nutri-washing, which is putting healthy words on junk food. And I took a picture, I posted it on the page of, they were Dorito-like chips.
Yeah.
And they had all these healthy words on the front of the packaging. And then you turn it over and the list of ingredients was as long as my thumb in the tiny, itty little bitty print.
Right, in a 6-point that's required for that type of
Right. So that's something that they talked about, was how the food industry puts healthy words to trick us, to make us think that it's healthy when it's actually not.
Although if you're going to grab a bag of Doritos and you're thinking, oh, this is healthy, I'm not so sure that's...
It's probably not?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So that's funny. This was also interesting, and I'm just making, I put some highlight marks of stuff I wanted to talk to you guys about, so there's a lot more in here I'm not even sharing. But protein became kind of a cult level thing that you had to have when it was originally discovered and then tested on animals, that protein helped animals grow faster, so therefore it must be better for humans. And so here's the interesting thing. So protein is easier for your body to process than meat protein. Let me rephrase that. Meat protein is easier for your body to process than plant protein.
Right.
And so that was thought to be a good thing. It's easier to process.
But it's closer to what we already have as muscle.
It just works. It's just better, faster, I guess. Not better. That's the wrong word. Faster. And it turns out they thought that was better, and it's not. Mm-hmm. Faster is actually not good, because what it does, and we've talked about this here before. Good morning, Dave. There, Dave Price, that's my massage therapist. I called that a little bit ago.
Hey,
help me out with my shoulder. So protein that's easier to process, which is the meat protein, actually makes your cells move faster, which means things like cancers and that kind of thing also go faster.
And
your body,
fat,
your body can't keep up with taking care of it.
Right.
And so the idea that meat protein was better and higher quality came from the idea that it grows animals faster. And then they later found it was easier for us to process. And it turns out easier to process is bad because it allows our bodies to not take time to clean and to take time to just build, which we've talked about with insulin before.
Right, right.
So I thought that was an interesting kind of history of why protein, meat protein, became this like god of food.
Mm-hmm.
So your body will only break down muscle if you're not eating enough protein. So as long as you're eating enough protein, your body will burn fat, not muscle.
Right.
And we talked about that before.
Which is only 10% of your caloric intake has to be protein.
Yeah.
And the other thing too, and we said this before, but I think it's important to keep saying it, is that yes, there are 9 essential amino acids. And actually they're talking about adding a 10th one. But point being is that yes, and you need all those through your food, but you don't need those every time you sit down to eat.
As long as you give it over the course.
Right, right. It's a combination over a period of time that you're consuming all those types of proteins.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the myth is that when you eat one piece of protein, it has to have all the 9 essential amino acids.
And it doesn't.
And it doesn't.
And so you don't have to mix and match your food. I know we've talked about that you can. It's not necessary. As long as you eat them over the course, you're fine.
Right.
Something else I learned, I did not know this. So the recommended daily allowance, you know, the number they put on the back of packages in the nutrition column, I thought that was an average for the average human. They, you know, the 2,000 calories, I thought that was an average number. Turns out it's not an average number. There's a different number that they don't use, and it's called estimated average requirement. So estimated average requirement, what they never talk to you about, is the average intake for the average male, because they always use men, right? Then who cares about the girls? Mm-hmm. Use men. So there's the estimated average requirement, and then what they do to get the number that they do use, which is the recommended daily allowance. I have to think about what these letters mean. They take the average and they add two standard deviations. And so for those of you who don't do a whole lot of stuff with standard deviations, because I know they're confusing, what that means is they take the persons that are at 98%, whatever the 98% of what people need is, that's what they're using. And so that 2,000 calories covers 98% of the population, but it's way too much for most of us, because most of us aren't at the 98th percentile of whatever the caloric intake is. So I thought that that was bizarre. Like, I thought they were giving us an average. Nope, they're giving us the top end of the scale.
Right.
On every single package you ever read, it's the top end of the scale.
So, and if you're trying to promote the food industry, you want to be on the heavy side, not on the light side, because you want people to eat more, you know?
Oh, that's very hot.
Yes.
Burn my mouth.
Mm, don't do that.
No, it's not good.
You know, keep the food industry and all the...
strong.
Yeah, keep it strong.
That's what's important.
You know, and it's a tough battle. I mean, at what point do you say, you know, don't do this and you can wipe out an industry? You can't really do that. I mean, it ruins economies, so...
It's a challenge.
It's a challenge.
But in the meantime, we don't want it. I know, right, Bridge? That was my response when they said it in my class. I'm like, no, that's the wrong answer. So I agree with you. So and they taught me something I did not know, which I told Russ, and he was like, yeah, I know that. I'm like, why didn't you ever tell me?
Yeah.
So on the package, they give you the calorie amount, and then they give you fat in grams.
Mm-hmm.
And you have no way to be able to say, well, how much of that grams of fat is in that calories? Like, it gives you percentages. So here's what you do, and this was so cool. You take the grams of fat that they give you, and you multiply it times 9, and that gives you the amount of calories per serving that are fat. And then you can look at it and say, okay, if there's 200 calories total in a serving, and if I take this number and multiply it by 9 for fat and I get 100, it means it's 50% fat.
Right.
So I'll type that up and so you guys can see it, because I know just talking about it, it's probably super confusing. But if you take grams of fat and multiply times 9, it gives you the amount of calories in that amount of fat.
And on the other side of it, your carbohydrates and your protein, you would multiply by 4. So less than half of a calorie for a protein or a carbohydrate than you'd get from fat.
Right.
And I've been, because I was a bodybuilder, I've known that for
all the stuff he knows. Yeah, 30, and I'm like, look how cool this is. He's like, I already know that.
Yeah.
So calories for fat, 9 per gram, and calories for carbohydrates and protein, 4 per gram. So you can figure that out. And as we've mentioned before, calories are a completely fake, made up thing.
Made up number, yeah.
But there you go. Now you have some data for whatever that means. I already talked to you about protein and cancer growth. Let's see what else I have in here highlighted. They talked again, I know we've said it before, and if you were following the post I made about Russ making bread, somebody commented that they were shocked that we eat carbs. And there's a whole conversation in there about how carbs are good for you, specifically whole food starches.
Mm.
And there's a whole module on just carbs, and they talk about how about 80% of your calorie intake should be from carbs, that's
right.
The way humans are designed.
Mm-hmm.
Every single tissue in your body can use carbs for fuel.
Right.
Now, I'm not talking about fake food processed carbs.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about simple carbs. And bread is definitely more toward the process. So don't eat straight bread. I'm not, especially not white bread. That's silly.
Yeah.
But potatoes, brown rice, all the tubers, beans, those are carbs, those are starches, and they're good for you. So eat those. There's a whole like thing about
that. Right. And the thing that you told me that you learned, which I find kind of disappointing, I guess, is that even when something says 100% whole wheat, it's not. And we're trying to figure this out. So this is investigation in process on this one.
Because they can apparently put whole wheat on packaging and it's not actually whole wheat. And I'm confused. They didn't really get into it, or at least as far as I've gotten, they haven't gotten into it yet. Or maybe I need to go back and look at it again. But I was very confused because I'm like, how can it say whole wheat if it's not whole wheat? It either is or it isn't. But as we know with the government and the food industry, that's not the truth.
And that's what they do. They mix words and spin it in a way that they can get away with that confuses the consumer.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And so they talking a lot about lipids and fats, which I did not know lipids and fats were different things. I thought it meant one thing, but apparently a lipid is an oil that is liquid at room temperature, and fat is a fat that is solid at room temperature. And they can take a lipid and turn it into something more like a fat by hydrogenating it, which you know margarine is, where they add hydrogen to it. And they explain how it straightens out the chains and makes it like, I won't get into the science.
I didn't tell you that.
Don't eat that stuff.
I didn't tell you that I saw an article today. I didn't actually read it yet, but on my one of my feeds that said, the death of margarine was the title.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Good. That would be good. Margarine's not food.
No.
They think it is, but it's not food. Let's see. What else did I say? I have other... See all my notes? Oh, you can't tell. Pages and pages of notes I have. So, oh, they talked about, and we talked about this before, omega-6 versus omega-3. Mm-hmm. Apparently, the ideal ratio is 1-to-1, or at best, 3-to-1, so 6-to-3. But in the American diet, it's as high as 50-to-1.
Right.
So obviously that's a challenge. And that comes from all of the processed oils that we're eating, especially corn oils and that kind of thing have a lot of
six.
And the meat that you're eating, because it's not eating plants, the animals you're eating, I don't mean you personally, I mean you generally,
right,
are eating, they're not eating their normal diet of plants. They're being fed corn and soy.
Right.
So instead of having the omega-3 in it that it might have had 50 years ago,
grass-fed, yeah,
now it's full of omega-6. So that also is ratcheting up the amount of omega-6 that you're taking
and,
in.
And don't think you'll be doing better if it says it's a grass-fed beef, but has it be a grass-finished beef?
Right, because so, they still finish it with corn.
Right, exactly.
So it's interesting that the way that it was explained to me, the way that omega-6 and omega-3 work in your body is that 6 brings up inflammation and 3 brings down inflammation. And obviously inflammation, especially in case of injury and healing, is good. You want that. So 6 has a job, and then 3 keeps it under control and keeps it from being like out of control. If your 6 is 50 times the amount of your 3, you're going to have a lot of inflammation, because that's what 6 does. It's its job. So I thought that was interesting. I didn't know that about how they work kind of in tandem, but against each other. So I thought that was an interesting little blurb that I learned. Oh, I wrote down salad dressing has omega-6 in it, and I put a frowny face. Because you guys know I like salad dressing. Right. Although last week I put applesauce on my salad.
You did.
That was really good.
Yeah.
So I may have found an answer to not eating salad dressing.
This is organic applesauce. It's,
yeah, and all it is apples. There's
apples,
nothing else in it.
Just crushed apples, yes.
Obviously. So let's see. What else do I have that might be interesting to you guys real quick? The calories from food labels I already talked about. It says plant-based food fragments and animal-based foods equal illness, and we try to fix it with pills and potions.
Yeah,
it's a true statement. That's what we do. So, and they said what they'd like to see is, we know that plants are good for us. Like, and I've said this before, I'm not telling you anything. This is not news. We know that plants are good for us, but the way that science is set up is that the whole food plant-based side has to always defend how it's healthy and it's good and it's good for us and we should do it. And then the other side gets to say, oh, this is healthy, and plant side has to go, no, actually that's not.
Right.
And what we need to do is kind of set whole food plant-based as the standard and then say, okay, beat this.
Right,
exactly. Because that's not what's happening right now.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting.
And the thing to keep in mind, and you already mentioned this, is that why do supplement companies go to plants to make supplements?
Right, because that's where the good stuff is.
That's where the good stuff is. I mean, go look at your supplements. Go look at your vitamins and your minerals. And it's all organic material that they're trying to either copy or use.
Yep. So that's as far as I've gotten. And like I said, there was a whole bunch of stuff about the environment and about the government and all of that. I didn't get into that here because I think you guys are much more interested in the health side, because that's what's interesting to me. When I was reading it and listening to the lectures, I'm like, I care, but I don't care. Mm-hmm. Tell me about the plants.
Exactly.
So that's what I've got so far, my pages of notes. And I'm only like partway through the first
module. Yeah.
Well, so there's modules and then there's classes. Okay. So I'm through the first like section. And so I'm working on it, and I'll tell you more as I learn more, and I will type these up and share them
on the website.
On the website.
Right.
So did we do anything else this weekend we should tell them quickly?
I did cardio yesterday.
Russ did two times cardio.
Well, I did Friday and I did a Sunday.
And you did yesterday here.
So what I wanted to say in the beginning when we were talking about the workout is that I've not been mentioning that I've done my cardio blitz recently. And the reason being is not that I don't think it actually works. I do think it actually is a good way to get some cardio in if you don't have a lot of time. Problem is I want to spend that time when I'm in the gym using weights. And I wind up sacrificing my weightlifting time to my cardio time. So what I'm trying to do now is pick a time in the evening, you know, around 5 o'clock or so, where I can spend a half hour or so on the AMT, because we're fortunate enough to have a gym quality AMT in the house.
We do.
And I try to do that, and that's where I'm picking up my cardio now. And hopefully we'll be able to do that 4 to 5 times a week.
We'll and when see. It gets warm, we'll ride outside.
Then we'll take our bikes out.
Because we do love, yeah. We do ride outside.
Exactly.
So I'm not getting the cardio that I should, and that's partly because my hip is still bothering me, but Dave is working on that too.
Right.
So we're going to fix it up, and I'm going to be fine.
Exactly.
So, but that's I know I just ran through a whole bunch of information. I like deluged you. Here's some data, but I thought it was stuff you might find interesting.
Exactly.
The most interesting thing to me was that the recommended daily allowance is not an average. It's for the like 98th person so it covers everybody.
Right.
So we need to stop looking at that is relevant to us, because it's not.
Right. And as I said to you, how could you possibly have a average recommended allowance for the general population when everybody is so individual? I mean, we are all different people. We have different lives. We have different, you know, body structures. So how do you actually come up with an average?
And then they don't even give you the average. They give you something else.
Right. Then they give you something else. So. The solution is to overgive and then figure everybody will be okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, they're overfeeding us, but we knew that, right? Yeah. That's not news either. The government and the big food is definitely overfeeding us.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm going to try and edit my video. I made potato enchiladas over the weekend. And so I'm going to try and edit that video so I can post it. I can see me chop vegetables really fast again.
Right.
I posted one for the tortilla soup, over the week, I guess last week.
And we are playing with some other ideas that we're trying to come up with, of ways to do things
For
the website.
If you guys have anything you want to know,
No, that's okay. I was saying, with Facebook, we're limited. We can't put half-hour videos on Facebook. Nobody will ever watch them.
Yeah, although we do talk for 20 minutes every morning.
Yeah, but it's live. I think it's a little bit different.
Yes, Laura, they are good. They were better the second day. The first day, not as good. And I did tweak the recipe, but they turned out well.
Yeah. So anyway.
But if you have stuff that you want to know about what we do and about our health and about what we're learning, please ask, because those of you who are here with us in the beginning have the opportunity to kind of influence how this goes and where we go with it. So don't be shy about throwing stuff out to say, hey, what about this? Or I'm interested in that. And take the survey. It's on the R&R Journey page. That's very helpful for us to know kind of what to do.
Mm-hmm.
So there's going to be a here with us from the beginning price when we start the website. So we're super excited.
And also what's really exciting about another exciting factor, and I don't know if we've talked about this, we probably did, but I'm going to say it again, is that we're going to have a community
page.
System on our website.
Yeah.
So you'll be able to, people that are members will be able to talk and compare and support each other through a, you know, chat like.
We're not going to use the Facebook groups because that Facebook controls it and they can shut it down.
Right.
If it's on our website, then we get to control
and
it.
And Robyn wants to take all the previous questions that we've gotten and start conversations on there so you can interact with those or start new ones.
Yep.
So that's kind of exciting.
Yeah. We're working on it. We're working on it.
Yes.
So we won't keep you any longer. Those are the notes I have so far. And I will continue to let you know as I go through this. If I come across things that are like aha moments for me, I will definitely share those with you.
Okay.
I think we're done.
And so with that, we will say, eat real food, not too much,
mostly plants.
Have a great day.
We'll see you tomorrow, guys.